In the dark maze of the Chernobyl sarcophagus lies this object, known as the elephant's foot. When it was discovered, a short time next to it was enough to deliver a lethal dose of radiation. Decades later, it remains surrounded by myths and misconceptions. But the truth is, this formation is just the tip of the iceberg of a truly nightmarish phenomenon called lava-like fuel-containing masses. It defines everything that will be done at the Chernobyl nuclear power plant for the next few decades. This is a story of one of the darkest secrets of Chernobyl. In August 1986, data obtained by program Buoy proved that after the Chernobyl disaster, around 90% of the reactor's nuclear fuel remained inside the building. However, there was no understanding of its exact condition. Among those searching for answers was Alexander Borovoy, a physicist of the Kurchatov Nuclear Institute. You may remember him from our project we made last year, when we recreated the first ever Chernobyl robot based on his written memories. Along with that story, his records described another moment. We found it in one of the rooms at the 6-meter level in the fall of 1986. To see the elephant's foot, you had to crawl through a rather narrow gap. Well, narrow at least for someone of my size. A few meters through the gap brought you into a service corridor. To the right was a room that proved very useful for us in thermal reconnaissance. And to the left, the corridor widened, and there in the distance it stood. A massive black droplet with a smooth surface. It was surrounded by cool draft and a radiation field that reached 8,000 rangens per hour. This was our first encounter with the most extraordinary substance cooked in the infernal kitchen of the Chernobyl disaster. The first question was, what exactly is it? Initially, its metallic shine led researchers to believe it was lead dropped into the reactor from helicopters. But it soon became clear that this was not only something entirely different, but also something that actually held answers to how the reactor meltdown had unfolded. The accuracy of the levels Borovoy mentioned is still an open question, though indeed it was extremely radioactive. That's why numerous attempts to take a sample failed. A small cart equipped with a drill couldn't break the material, because it was far too solid. Then, a soldier, acting quite impulsively, tried to strike it with an axe, which resulted only in his overexposure. Finally, in 1988, a sample was obtained. A common opinion is that it was done by shooting it with the rifle. Analysis revealed that it was a strange black ceramic, primarily silica fused with uranium oxides and other radioactive isotopes. Over the following years, up until 1992, more formations were discovered across the sarcophagus. They were found to contain different types of ceramics, many of which outclassed the elephant's foot in terms of danger. And to explain why this is the case, we need to look at how all this material formed. On April 26, 1986, the explosion threw the upper biological shield of the reactor into the air. Fragmented concrete, metal, and other debris fell into the reactor pit. Simultaneously, the impact displaced the bottom shield of the reactor 4 meters down, connecting the former active zone to hole 305/2 below. Sand and serpentine from the side biological protection damaged by the explosion began falling into the area. At that moment, the temperature inside the active zone reached at least 1500 degrees Celsius or 2700 degrees Fahrenheit, and it continued to rise, driven by the residual products of nuclear reaction. Over the next 12 hours, the intense heat melted the zirconium tubes containing uranium pellets in the fuel rods. This created a liquid uranium-zirconium-oxygen phase, which gradually began to melt sand and serpentine. The resulting silicate was so unusual that later in Ukrainian it was named Chornobylite. In English, the term corium is more common, and often it's used to mark FCMs in hull, but in fact it is just one of components of them. Around midday of April 26, the molten mixture reached the bottom biological shield. It melted a significant part of it before flowing into the hole 305/2 below. This hole housed a cross-shaped concrete foundation supporting the reactor's base, which was also partially melted. As the lava consumed more materials, its heat emission and temperature began to decrease. Similarly, its composition and appearance became increasingly diverse depending on its location. And this determined what happened next. On the floor of room 305/2 were intakes for large steam valves designed to handle excess steam during emergencies. Through the valve number 4, the lava flowed into the hole 210/7 below, forming the flow known as the Great Vertical. This massive flow contained molten sand and serpentine, which mostly solidified into brown, chocolate-colored ceramics. This type of ceramic contained nearly twice as much uranium as the black variant, making it far more radioactive. From another side of 305/2, a smaller vertical flow passed through different valves. This flow primarily consisted of black ceramic. But the lava didn't stop there, and through 5 steam pipes it reached the steam bubbler pool below, which was still filled with water. Upon contact, the upper layers of lava instantly foamed due to the released steam. This created lightweight, pumice-like masses that likely floated in the water. Why do we know that? Because once the water was drained, these masses were found near the drains. But the main part of the lava was too hot for foaming, so it solidified into grayish pink or brown granules, forming large heaps covered by glass-like crust. By many parameters, these formations are far more dangerous than the elephant's foot. But how did the elephant's foot actually form? This happened only approximately 2.5 days after the explosion. By then, the vertical flows had likely stopped, but melting in 305/2 continued. Eventually, the lava found an escape route, a bridge leading to the adjacent hole 304/3. This marked the beginning of what became known as the Great Horizontal Flow. It moved slowly, at a rate of about 5 meters or 16 feet per hour. But it eventually covered the entire floor of hole 304/3. The result was a matte black ceramic layer riddled with gas-created pores and large voids. Then the flow reached a doorway and spilled into a corridor spreading in two directions. The larger part traveled east until it reached cable channels that provided a path to a lower level. It was here, in a room 217/7, where it stopped, forming the infamous elephant's foot and stalactites. Both formations solidified into shiny, charcoal-black ceramics with surfaces smooth and glossy. Around midday on April 29, the lava began to cool down to 100 degrees and started to solidify completely. This means that by the end of April, FCMs largely got the shape they have now. But behind, they left a landscape of absolute devastation. And it suggests that when it was happening, it might have looked like something out of a true nightmare. Honestly, I wonder, what color did that lava glow? However, what we have described was reconstructed only years after the disaster through extensive and risky research. The problem is, during the construction of the sarcophagus, unknowingly much of the fuel-containing masses were sealed beneath layers of concrete. This, combined with the damage caused by explosion itself and the intense radiation levels, made it incredibly complex or even impossible to access many areas. In 1987, Alexander Borovoy became the head of the operative group of the Khrushchev Complex Expedition. He proposed drilling to gather data. It was a dangerous task, and one event serves as a powerful example. It was late evening of May 1st, 1988, a holiday, when I was called to the phone. The driller foreman was speaking.
Some kind of vapor or mist is coming out of borehole, and the wellhead is barely visible now. Soon it will reach the machine, so what we should do? Evacuate the people immediately, close all the doors and try to seal them as best as you can, and wait for me. I'm coming over now.
We approached the doors leading to the corridor that provided access to the drilling machine area. The doors were shut but not sealed. So even in the corridor, the air was thick with visible mist. While I was trying to assess the situation, a voice suddenly called out behind me.
Hey, pass, show me your pass.
And out of mist emerged a soldier improperly wearing a respirator.
What are you doing here? Did they forget you? No, sir, I cannot leave my post.
How long has the mist been here?
About 5, maybe 7 minutes.
So now listen, if you stand here for 10 more minutes, you might never leave anymore. It will be easier end for you. Well, I said harsh and wrong words, but I didn't have any choice. The solder ran off and we began using water hoses to settle the mist. That mist was fuel dust. How it appeared? So the water meant to cool the drilling equipment had entered the area of high temperatures. So it began to evaporate rapidly, breaking down something and turning it into the dust. That something was the yet unknown fuel-containing mass in the hole 305/2. In a few days, another drill reached the reactor shaft. There was inserted a camera and it revealed a far more shocking discovery. The former active zone was nearly empty. This confirmed that the FCM deposits were far larger than initially imagined and they were not limited to the elephant's foot and few more known formations. The first calculations estimated that around 130 tons of nuclear fuel remained beneath the reactor. With fuel-containing masses having an average of 8% uranium, their total weight exceeded 1700 tons. Drilling continued for many years after. Thousands of samples were obtained and hundreds of detectors were installed inside the drilled shafts. This data helped reconstruct the how exactly and at which temperatures the lava traveled. And it made corrections to fuel distribution numbers based on chemicals found in the samples. But despite these efforts, there is still no definitive answer to the total extent of FCM deposits. And it looks like that many discoveries will only come during their eventual retrieval. But there is more. It has been observed that radiation levels around elephant's foot have gradually decreased over time. By the 1990s, it was possible to approach it and take close-up pictures and videos. And today it emits something about 100 rangens per hour, allowing limited work near it with proper precautions and time management. But closer observations have revealed something far more important. Fuel-containing masses are changing, and the elephant's foot is a prime example. In early photos, it had a metallic shine and distinct vertical column rising above it. By 1991, this column had begun to collapse, the shine had faded, and the surface was riddled with cracks. And while the ceramics and their crystal inclusions themselves were studied very well, the reasons for these changes remained not completely clear. Not so long ago, one more discovery was made. That gas-created cracks and voids inside the ceramics are interconnected with nanochannels. It looks that those appear because of countless alpha particles that are emitted inside the FCMs. So through those channels inside comes moisture and air, which start to react with various uranium oxides, ruining the ceramic from inside. What appears in result is one more source of a high-active, low-fraction fuel dust, which can form dangerous radioactive aerosols. So for years, various technologies have been developed to suppress it. And this is just one of the unique tasks of the Institute of the Safety Problems of Nuclear Power Plants, a specialized research institute based in the city of Chernobyl, which studies the sarcophagus and the fuel-containing masses. Eventually, these materials must be retrieved and safely confined, which is basically one of the main tasks of the new safe confinement. But the necessary technologies for particular cases and particular places are yet to be fully developed. In future episodes, we will continue to explore the secrets of the sarcophagus, or how it is correctly called, object shelter, perhaps the most complex structure ever built by mankind. Until then, check out our Patreon page for bonus reading, archival data and unique insights into Chernobyl as a phenomenon. The link is in the description below. This episode is a part of a series, so be sure to watch our other documentaries. Thank you for joining us and see you next time in the next episode of Chernobyl Uncharted.